Why even bother with something unless you're going to try your very best? So in this video, we're going to try our very best to get to the root of it. Okay, how can we really be saved from misery and fear and all of that? There's an answer. I've been contemplating this the last several days very intensely. And it's getting more clear all the time. First of all, though, let's start out with the times we live in, which I was shown something, how it's going to happen. I've said this before, we're going to be stampeded. The planet is going to be stampeded. There are a group of hardcore activists in the world who are experts at stampeding. And the large mass of people in the world right now can be easily stampeded in their actions, in their attitudes, into a highly emotionalized type of state through use of social media. We saw like the Arab Spring, all those, one country after the other fell like dominoes, largely through the use of social media and young people who would have all these buttons in them. If you push the buttons, you know, they react like robots. Easy to control, easy to stampede. The real responsibility of people here, the least you can do is to not have any buttons that can be pushed in any way. So people try to push buttons and just, you know, no response. You're not pushed one way or the other by all this radical rhetoric and polarization, etc. So that's what's one of the things that listening to these videos should help you with, is you should become less emotional, less passionate, less easy to rant and rave, and you just even when you're saying something admonishing, you're still calm, you're still composed, and you're not trying to push buttons all over the place. You're saying, leading people to greater composure and right use of time, right use of mind. So a stampede is coming, and stampedes happen very, very quickly. It's all set up. It's all set up to happen like a thief in the night. Now, where can our focus be to avoid this, to sidestep it? Our focus has to be on quote-unquote salvation, which means solving the continuity problem. When we say salvation, it means we have a problem, okay? And when we say we have a continuity problem, how do we get that? Because of whim. Whim generates a continuity problem. Where did whim come from? Whim came from spirit wanting to be greater than God, wanting to be prime creator. That's a whim. It's not an idea, it's a whim, really. It's the idea of whimsy, because it's not possible. So that's the etiology of the whole situation. We are now stuck with a continuity problem. So this is absolutely crucial that you understand this, that you have a continuity problem. When you understand this, people cannot push your buttons because you say, I got something better to do. I got something better than to attack this group or attack this group or something. I've got a severe continuity problem, and thanks, but I need to work on it, so I'll pass on all this other stuff. Don't have time for it. I've got this really bad problem. So it really helps you a lot to recognize you got a really severe problem. The rest of stuff, forget it. No, I'm not interested. I got this continuity problem. Now, how do we solve the continuity problem? This is the total gigantic question that we're working on here. And I made some more progress on this, not without difficulty. And how to present it. Simply put, the continuity problem we have is solved not by jettisoning this world and all perception, all things, objects of perception. Not by that, because that would cause a continuity problem for us. It comes about through, as I said, seeing a blessed world. Now, what does that mean, a blessed world? Well, I've said it means everything in association with God. You see, there's an association there. Okay, well, can we be more specific? Yes, yes, yes. Okay, this is what we'll do. We'll be more specific now. What we have to see to solve the continuity problem is each and every thing that we perceive extending beyond its concrete form into an expandedness, that goes, seems to go off into infinity. But the form, the concrete form is still there, okay? But there's this feeling, some sort of spiritual vision of this subtle expansion of all forms going out into spaciousness, to infinity. So there's a subtle sense of everything in an expanded way. And what this does is it reminds us that there, yes, there is infinite space in pure spaciousness, that you can expand it infinitely and not fall into an abyss. Because when we wanted to be prime creator, whim says, ah, there's an end to spaciousness, and we're beyond that. We're beyond it. All right? Basically, it's saying, hey, we're beyond God. Well, that means God has an end, right? So we have this terrible fear of an abyss, falling into this abyss, and we're contracted against that. We've shrunk ourselves down into thinking all we are is these bodies, these concrete forms. That's it. And what we've done by this is we've lost the sense of extension, which creation extends itself infinitely in all directions, continuously extending itself with the subtle essence, which goes on endlessly. So that is reality. We are so conditioned to this reification of looking at ourselves and everything else as these concrete forms that don't extend beyond themselves, you see, don't extend in spaciousness, that is a gigantic continuity problem, gap there for us. So, first step is to begin to see everything as expanding beyond itself, like in a poetic, subtle, poetic, beautiful way that you know, we can't touch it. We can't see it, we can't touch it, we can't grasp it. It's subtle. It's expanding beyond what you can touch or grasp or conceptualize. And you let it go into the boundlessness. It just continues on in a boundless way, endless way. And yet still you are aware of all the things sitting right in front of you. They're still there. Now, one thing that Jesus says in A Course in Miracles is to say that when you see little edges of light around everything, little edges of light. Now, what he means by light, I'm not sure, but light is a great symbol for expanding beyond yourself, right? If you take a light bulb, a flashlight, anything like that, and you shine it, you see, it light extends from the light bulb outwards. So, seeing little edges of light around everything would be like a first step in being aware that the experiencing an extension of all things beyond their concrete form in specific location and time and space, that there's an expansion, light travels, it expands, right? So that makes sense to me, it makes perfect sense. I haven't seen this, but from the standpoint of reason and theory, it fits right in. It fits right in. So I wouldn't be surprised if that was accurate. We'll have to have, you know, empirically experience it in order to for sure say, yeah, that's exactly what happens. But, you know, it could be literal light, or it could be metaphorically a subtle light, you know, the sort of a subtlety to it. I'm not sure. But, yeah, that makes perfect sense. So, in doing this reminds us of reality to such an extent that we are able to finally set down the idea of concrete form, solidified, crystallized form, into the and accept the uncrystallized nature of reality, the pure extension, pure knowing, pure extension beyond conception, beyond perception. So our focus is on the continuity problem and seeing things as having this expanding beyond what they are in a beautiful, subtle ways. I had a little tinge of this yesterday, this sort of expansion and a sort of a subtleness. And so it's coming along here, bit by bit by bit. So this is fundamental, basic spiritual theory, okay? I have a continuity problem based on whim, based on wanting to be greater than God. I have to resolve this continuity problem, otherwise I will continue on with whim. And how's the continuity problem solved? By seeing everything extending beyond its appearance, its concrete appearance, all right? And that's how it gets going, all right? So it's pretty simple, pretty simple. Seeing, that's called seeing a blessed world, So if we can theoretically understand this, then it's not such a big step to actually see it. Say, I expect to see it, this is what I expect to see, and now I'm seeing it, it all fits theoretically, so there's no uproar or instability at all. So, I don't know if that covers it or not. I wanted to look at any questions that might arise. Now, one thing that might be helpful is to not try to focus in on the surface of anything in particular. It's very important. That's why our spiritual traditions de-emphasize glamour, which is superficial surface appearances. De-emphasize bright, beautiful clothing, makeup, making yourselves look glamorous and beautiful and attractive and all this stuff. It that emphasizes the surface. What you're trying to do is you're trying to see what goes beyond the surface of these things. These things, what extends beyond that. So you sort of have a diffuse awareness, more of a diffuse awareness than trying to, you know, zoom in on some, you know, glittery object and its surface, that type of thing. The surface isn't important. The surface is not important for our purposes. All that's important is what extends beyond the surface. And I've said, in before you go to sleep, when these images arise in your mind, perhaps, or this imagery, don't try to lock focus on anything. Just let it all go by equally, without anything being more important. Even if the Buddha or whoever, the Christ shows up, just let it equal treatment. Okay, because you're not interested in even the Buddha or Christ. You're only interested in what extends beyond the Buddha and the Christ. What is the extension from that, from all things that arise? So train your mind in this direction. Train your mind in this direction. Now, everything abides in zero dimensionality of pure spaciousness already. This is the ultimate teaching. But we need to get there, we have to solve the continuity problem. All right, and that's, again, a gigantic problem. Getting worse all the time, for sure. Basically, all the marketing that's being done, advertising on superficial appearances and superficial, I mean, everything is superficial in this world, isn't it? There's no depth anymore to anything. It's all just, you know, pagan superficiality, reaction, emotion, reaction, set up totally to be easily stampeded, and things are being tried out, various things are being tried out to stampede the population. The purpose of that is to wipe out spiritual aspiration on this planet. That is the actual purpose. And that's the purpose of whim, because whim feels threatened by truth, by facts, very threatened. And spiritual aspiration, the purpose of it is to get to the fact that everything always is already abiding in the perfect, supremely pure, and smoothed out even super matrix, okay, which we call God. Everything always is already there. There's no place else to be. There is no place else to be. None whatsoever. There are no dimensions. There's no other place to be. Reality is zero dimensional. Reality is zero dimensional. There is no dimension to it whatsoever. It's simply everything. It abides in this one zero dimensional pure spaciousness. Everything, always. Nothing more, nothing less. It's all the same. That's the oneness. The oneness of all is the oneness of abiding in this zero-dimensional pure spaciousness we call God. So that's the aim. The ultimate aim is to accept this. Okay, but we have this continuity issue. So we can tell ourselves, it can be helpful, like, just sort of accept zero-dimensionality. Zero-dimensionality. In other words, all decoration in time and space, no matter what realm you're imagining, it's all equally abiding in the super matrix, equally. There are no levels. There are no real levels. There are no real dimensions whatsoever. There's no real stratification at all. It's all same abidance. The abidance is exactly the same no matter what the decoration. Whether the decoration is a thought, an imagination, a sound, a thing, an experience, all everything has the same abidance in the super matrix. Pure spaciousness, pure absence, no difference whatsoever. Same, 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 same. This is the ultimate truth. So we can get a sense of everything as we look about it. We can say, hey, everything right now is equally abiding in pure spaciousness without me doing anything, without anything having to happen whatsoever. And all the happenings are also equally abiding in pure spaciousness. There's nothing to do, nowhere to go to make it happen. Nothing has to happen at all for this to be true. And you can get a sense of this. I have been getting a sense of this. But also, there is this step of solving the continuity issue, apparently by seeing an extension, everything having extension into subtlety and expansion, everything expanding from its concrete appearance. So I would say both of those are important. The ultimate realization is something we can at least get a sense of. We can sort of feel it. It's like, kind of relax into it and say, and you feel it. It's amazing. It's just like mind-blowing because you realize, wow, it's always been this way. There's nothing out of place. That's why the great teachers say everything's already perfect. What are you talking about making the world a perfect place? They say it's already perfect, absolutely perfect. Nothing's out of place. How could anything be out of place? Everything is already abiding in God. Effortlessly. So that's the teaching of Lonchenpa, which is, you know, the ultimate teaching, but we have to solve the continuity problem that we have. So we have to step it down, pull back from that a little bit, don't reject it at all. Radical Dzogchen, don't reject it, but put it in the right context, because Radical Dzogchen actually can be misapplied, and I believe it has been. Back when Tibetan Buddhism came to the West, first they got kicked out of Tibet in 1951, and went to India, and then from India began disseminating, gradually pushed through to the Western world and globally. And some of this Dzogchen, Radical Dzogchen teaching really permeated the psyche of the West, but it got misinterpreted, okay? And that has caused a lot of problems, actually, which I understand why Samaya, or the secrecy of this, is actually helpful, really, because if you don't really have the right context for it, easily, You can think it means anything goes. It doesn't matter what we do, anything goes. It turns into hedonism, you know? Materialistic hedonism. And that's not the issue at all. So that's why I'm bringing in this continuity issue. I'm saying it's more important. It's more important than Radical Dzogchen. The continuity issue is more important, because that's admitting, hey, I've got a huge problem, and I've got to find the solution to this problem. So forget about hedonism and all this secular, materialistic, humanism, all this nonsense. You know, I've got a really severe problem. You know, say that to yourself. I've got a horrendously severe problem, the continuity problem. I can't accept the fact that everything is always abiding in pure spaciousness effortlessly, and there's nothing that anyone has to do at all whatsoever. I'm not able to actually accept that, and, you know, entirely without trying to mix it with whim, without trying to mix with whim. So what happened is Radical Dzogchen got mixed in with whim. And then you had all these crazy gurus who messed everybody up, you know, in a lot of ways, and really polluted the water, spiritual waters, and caused us an enormous amount of problems. Because they mixed the Radical Dzogchen teachings with whim. That's a bad, 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 bad thing. And of course they're, you know, rationalize it all the way, like, hey, everything's okay, I don't have to explain it, you know, it's all good, and you feel like you can't combat that, you know. So what I've done here is help everybody, all the spiritual aspirants of the world, by recentering them and saying, hey, no, I have a continuity problem. I don't care what this big shot guru says. I have a severe continuity problem, period. You know, and so just centers you. I don't care who it is It could be the big, greatest guru in the history of the planet and the universe. You still have a severe continuity problem. And don't feel inferior, don't feel, you know, because then you're into whim. You're into whim. Because the solution of the continuity problem is something definitely you experience as very profound and very centered, and you know it. As Jesus said, you see the tinges of light around everything. You see everything going beyond itself to this infinite expansion and subtlety, and you are in this very blissed condition. And there is no teacher or guru in the universe that can tell you that you don't know, you're wrong or whatever like that. No, can't touch you. So to be safe, you have to be centered in this continuity issue. That's why samaya, or secrecy, was used in Tibetan Buddhism, because they realized that when this gets into the hands of those who are not properly grounded in working through the nine steps, as it were, towards this expansion and getting used to that expansion beyond the physical concrete reifications, they would mix it with whim, and then you get over you get either hostile or you start acting crazy, or you get over enthusiastic. I mean, all sorts of permutations that mess things up happen. So they said, hey, let's keep this teaching for those who are ready for it. And so unfortunately this got unleashed upon the West, and you got all the sorts of very unfortunate situations actually taking place. We have not been well served in the West by our spiritual teachings. We have not. And that's why we lost our way. We've really lost our way in this whole secular, materialistic, humanistic, fascist, Stalinistic, New World Order thing is ready to pounce, and the activists are ready to pounce and stampede everybody, because we didn't stick to our basics. In the Christian culture really had the basics right, and they said, look, I'm a sinner. I'm missing the mark of God. My relationship with God is severely messed up, which is absolutely true. Because why? We have a severe continuity problem. And we cannot accept God as it is, meaning the super matrix. Everything is equally abiding in that, always and forever. There is no beyond God, you see. So we can't accept it because we have a continuity problem. So we have this quote-unquote sin. We're not in a proper relationship with reality as it is. And this keeps us centered, actually. It keeps us centered and keeps us from going into this crazy wisdom, radical Dzogchen, mixed with whim, kind of stuff that anything goes, and, any sort of behavior goes, any sort of lack of discipline goes, and all this garbage, it's not true. It's absolutely not true. You're supposed to lead a very sober and sane life. Your behavior, you're supposed to try to be as best as possible. You're supposed to discipline yourself. You're not supposed to be going around worshiping idols, worshiping gurus, worshiping physical reifications. You're not supposed to be doing that. That can get you into trouble. A lot of trouble, especially if the teacher is mixing, radical Dzogchen with whim, then you're really in big trouble. If you start trying to worship that teacher, you're going to get used, very badly used. So try to keep it in the context of I have a very severe problem, and that's it. And what can help me? What is the theory in helping? What is it? Let reason see it. Let reason see it. So I don't worship my teachers at all. There was a time when I was into that to some extent, but not now, that is for sure. The teacher appeared, I probably would just continue to have diffuse awareness. I try not to focus on it to the exclusion of anything else. And I don't feel I would get into any sort of worshiping mode at all. So, in the West, in these times, guru worship, I don't think it's a healthy thing at all. And over enthusiasm again is a sure sign of imbalance, and that you're mixing something radical Dzogchen with whim. The radical thing where everything's already perfect, so why should we worry? And then mixing that in, that's with whim, and then you just think, I can think anything, do anything, and then nothing matters. And you can't seem to extricate yourself from that. I understand. Very difficult. If you're not centered in the sense of I have a severe continuity problem, then you can't control yourself. I'm telling you. Been there, done that. It's horrible. You just don't seem to have a center. And you think, hey, not having a center means I'm free. No, it doesn't. Because you've not gotten free of whim. You've not solved the continuity problem at all. So, it is super important to get back to the sense of saying, I, and everybody else, we only have one problem. We have a continuity problem. That's it. But it's a severe, gigantic problem, and it has to be solved in a specific way, particular way. And it has to do with making no exception whatsoever, same-ness, evenness. Seeing everything you see it extending beyond itself and down to everything, a dead leaf, a piece of concrete, a piece of mud, some grass, you know, trees, some asphalt, a car, no exceptions whatsoever. So that means you see some supreme guru there, and you see extension beyond them. No different than seeing a lump of mud and seeing that extending also into infinity. Absolutely no difference. No difference. Now the great gurus can be helpful in encouraging you towards this. But the great gurus are extremely self-effacing, you know, they're just very self-effacing. Don't worship me, I'm nothing, just really super humble and kind and super humble and self-effacing, making no claims for themselves, that kind of thing. Those are the real gurus. They don't say, I'm the chosen one of God, I'm great, blah, 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 blah. No, because they know that solving the continuity problem is to see everything extending beyond itself equally. Nothing special, no specialness whatsoever. And they also know that you are abiding in the super matrix exactly to the same extent that they are and everything else is. So there's no such thing as greatness in reality whatsoever. Nothing is greater or lesser at all. So if you're caught up in guru worship or personality cults and stuff, you're forgetting that you have a continuity problem. You're forgetting it. You think, I'm solving it, it's solved. No, it's not. It's not solved. Because you're trying to go after specialness, which is the antithesis of resolving the continuity problem, which is no specialness. Now, when you believe in specialness, your buttons can be pushed. That is the problem. So the world right now is in this crazy mix between radical Dzogchen and whim, which gives rise to this enthusiastic feeling of specialness. And yeah, we can this. And it's easy to push the buttons because they feel it. Once you're specialness, they say, hey, your specialness is being threatened. You know, your specialness is being threatened. It's being threatened. Oh, you know, my salvation is being threatened. And then people become rabid and you tip over into very nasty situations very quickly. Whereas if you realize you have a problem, a severe continuity problem, and you know you have to make no exceptions, no specialness, every last thing without exception is blessed and goes and experiences as extending beyond itself, expanding beyond what it is to infinity, then there's no specialness at all. How can you have buttons to be pushed? That's why the saints and sages, etc., of history seem to be so calm and tranquil and composed and non-reactive and blissful. It doesn't matter the circumstances. They're experiencing this subtle expansion beyond all thingness, all concreteness, all reifications of imagination. See, my role is just reassure, share what I know, reassure, share what I know, reassure, say, yeah, this is important. Just focus on you. They say, I have a continuity problem. You know, them over there too, yeah, they do too. But my problem is the one that I have to resolve. I have to resolve it. By seeing nothing as special, nothing as outside spaciousness, nothing as more in the super matrix, the zero dimensionality. Zero dimensionality, how can anything be more in it and something be less in that, in zero dimensionality? Zero dimensionality is a very, very key understanding, super key understanding. And how do you relate to that conception? You really don't. It's deeper, isn't it? You get a sense, you just feel, oh yeah, I remember. Zero dimensionality is it. Because that's our reality. We haven't forgotten it. It's within us. I mean, we're within it. We're within zero dimensionality. Everything right now is perfectly abiding in zero dimensionality. Everything, without any exception whatsoever, already is in zero dimensionality. It's never been anywhere else. There's never been anywhere else. And that takes a huge burden off us. Oh my gosh. Now, try not to worry too much about, well, what happens? How am I going to act? This. You follow down that path, it's no fruit. It's fruitless down that path. Just get back and say, hey, I got a continuity problem. Okay, let's bring it back to things that I'm seeing here, experiencing, and my field of vision and experience, and the sense of that there's something going, expanding beyond each and everything, equally. Nothing special. And just keep plugging away at the very basics. I know it's difficult because you'll start thinking, yeah, I almost got it. Okay, now, you know, what am I going to say? What am I going to do? Where am I going to go? How am I going to earn a living? All this kind of stuff. And it just wears you out. I've never gotten any answer that way whatsoever. You just have to train yourself not to go down those speculations. And it's frustrating because you want answers, but I've never gotten any. Tell you the truth, I really have not gotten any as to what's going to be like. What am I going to do? I don't know. I really have no idea. Just don't know. Never received any clarification on that. So apparently that's a side trip that's tripping us up. What's important is to remain centered, that I have a continuity problem. And stop trying to think what you're going to do when you don't have one anymore, because you still got a severe one, and you need to work more on resolving it. Everybody has it, you see. Everybody has a very severe, very severe. So don't look up to people, don't look down on people. Just stay centered in your own work of clarification. Stay centered in your own work of clarification. Knowing that that's what others have to do too. So you're just doing what everybody has to do. Whether they do it now or later is up to them. But you're better off if you do it now, because otherwise you're going to keep suffering. And why keep suffering? We're already, everything again is already zero dimensional. Okay, this, all things are zero dimensional right now. There's no such thing as actual dimensions. Actual dimensions are just our decorations in spaciousness. Everything we've imagined to decorate, all sorts of realms, we've imagined so much. All sorts of different realms, different types of decorations. And we call these different dimensions. And we think that reality is stratified into dimensions. And some dimension is more included in pure spaciousness, and other dimensions are outside of it or less included. So all nonsense. It's all nonsense. Just imagination is just decoration and spaciousness. Pure space, decorations and zero dimensionality. That's all it is. Nothing more than that. Same. Every single decoration is exactly the same as any other decoration. Exactly the same. Dimension number 20, dimension number 3, dimension number 14, dimension whatever dimension, it's all, those are all just decorations. All equally abiding in zero dimensionality. They're already zero dimensional. Always have been, always will be. And analytically, we can't handle this. So if you've trained yourself not to go into an analytical thinking, nor empathy, emotional thinking. There's something. You just there's a straight track of tremendous intuition that just, and memory just says yeah. Nothing needs to be said. Zero dimension. You just You just realize, yeah, that's true. That's true. How could there be any dimensions? How could there be any differences? How can there be any real differences whatsoever among decorations? Impossible. There are no real differences whatsoever. Everything, all included in the super matrix of zero dimensionality. And there's nothing more you can say. It's just a complete yes, you know, it's just a complete truth. It's truth itself. And we can gradually, you know, get closer to accepting that. Say, yeah, this is true. This is what I'm going to accept eventually. So let's solve the continuity problem so this can be accepted. All right. It's not so cold anymore here. We've had like 11 days in a row of hard freeze here. Last night was 28 again, so it's basically 28 or below for like 11 straight nights. And went down to 24 and a half one night. And so tonight it's supposed to be above freezing, but we'll see. Maybe it will. And then it's supposed to actually start climbing up and be pretty nice here, actually. Upper 60s and upper 30s at night. So hopefully I'll be able to keep taping out here. It's not as brutally cold out here now. And that's great. Because I do most of my taping at nighttime. Outside, and no heater or anything. It's cold. But very apropos, because the world is a very cold place right now, right? And you have to speak up and still make your way, even in this very chilling, bone-chilling cold of this terrible situation that's arisen in the world, where people have been preconditioned to be easily stampeded. I've seen the whole thing take place. I've seen the preconditioning taking place and tried to stop it, and I said, wow, eventually this is going to be a gigantic problem in the world. And then the activists are here, who, again, the specialists, they're specialists in how to trigger a stampede, and you know how it'll go. Protection. I have a severe continuity problem. Sorry, guys. I can't deal with that right now. No way. So I'm just gonna stay locked into this, working on this severe continuity problem, and crazy to do anything else, to tell you the truth, isn't it? I mean, this is such a gigantic, incredibly severe, terrible problem, the continuity problem, that spending time on something else is nuts. It's whimsical, totally whimsical. I look at the world, and for me, the world is entirely whimsical. Utterly whimsical. The stuff that people do is so whimsical, I just can't believe it. I really can't. I said, what are you doing? You're just total whim. You got this incredibly severe, terrible problem, and you're not doing anything about it. You're just ignoring it, thinking that by ignoring it, it's going to go away. That's total whim. Total whim. The great teachers tell you, hey, you cannot ignore your effort. Your effort, your life has to be this effort, has to be dedicated, has to be spiritual aspiration, has to be your life. And what's happening is whim is wants to exterminate spiritual aspiration so it can say, ah, there's nothing else other than whim, so whim must be true. You know, whim must be true because I don't see any spiritual aspiration anywhere. Whim feels very threatened by spiritual aspiration, so it wants to extinguish it, absolutely extinguish it. And so that's why I say, relocation is a possibility, if it comes to that. If it comes to that, I'm all for it, absolutely. And the scriptures tend to support that, the relocation will take place. So we will see. But in the meantime, we have a severe continuity problem. We can't waste time with all that other nonsense. People, if people are not focusing on that, I don't have time for them. Because they don't have time for truth. They don't have time for salvation. They want to continue to go on ignoring it, thinking it's going to go away someday. That's whim. It's continuity problem's not going to go away by ignoring it. That's whim. Of course that's whim. So you've got to get into spiritual aspiration and keep it going. One of the most important things that a great guru said was that the fire of spiritual aspiration has to be kept burning continuously. You can't let it go out. Don't let it go out. Very bad thing to let it go out. So every day you have to put in some more effort. Every day. It's an everyday thing. It's a lifelong everyday thing. And it's necessary. It is necessary. So don't let a day slip by that where you engage in whim entirely. I mean, we all engage in whim at some point. Maybe after this video, I might go and watch the basketball game or something. I waste the time, right? So, but we have to every day make huge progress. efforts. I've made tremendous efforts today, almost the entire day, starting at 8 o'clock. I've been taping on an MP3 recorder all day long. So I may have taped already today, inflation in between all of that, maybe 8 to 10 hours today of tremendous effort. That's the fire of spiritual aspiration. And it's just something, it's like people who work out every day. They run every day, they work out every day. They stay in great shape. So we need to stay in great spiritual shape by continuing this, you know, spiritual aspiration of hey, I've got a really incredibly gigantic, severe problem, continuity problem. It's just unbelievably difficult and severe. And so I've got to really keep working on this. Otherwise, no way am I going to get it resolved. No way. No way. But if I do work on it, I'm going to get it resolved. No question about it. There is an answer there, and I can gradually let it dawn upon me. And this eventually is going to be resolved. And then, you know, I'm able to then expand the way I'm supposed to be as living light, the very essence of reality is living light. And I will be able to once again function the way that I was created to function and have no fear of falling into an abyss in pure spaciousness, in zero dimensionality. Okay? How can there be an abyss in zero dimensionality? Even the abyss is dwelling within zero dimensionality. So you cannot fall in or out of zero dimensionality. Cannot. All right? So, again, stay centered in that you have a continuity problem. Say, I have a continuity problem. Stay centered there, and the radical Dzogchen mixed with whim won't get you. Won't get you. It won't get you. It's more important to look at this. The radical Dzogchen, I'm sprinkling it in here like seasoning on a salad. Okay, that's fine. You still got to eat the salad. The salad's there. Okay, the continuity problem is there. How to solve it's there. And so this helps us go forward. All right? Very great. That's it for this one.